Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya al mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Firstly, I'd like to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the opportunity to benefit from this great program. I'd like to thank ICNA and the organizers and all of the volunteers that are working behind the scenes to bring this program to us. And I'd like to thank all of the participants for watching, and inshallah may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to benefit from what we are experiencing today. Inshallah, the next presentation will be by Sheikh Omar Sulaiman. Sheikh Omar is the CEO and the founder of Yaqeen Institute. And inshallah, the title of his presentation today is When My Servant Asks Me, Indeed I Am Here. Sheikh Omar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wa la 'udwana illa 'ala adh-dhalimin wa 'aqibatu lil-muttaqin. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik 'ala 'abdika wa rasulika Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa 'ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman katheera. Subhanallah, I was imagining myself sitting in the front row listening to Imam Siraj speaking, and really missing the opportunity that we had to come together. And the ICNA convention was something that you'd look forward to on an annual basis. And subhanAllah, you know, as we're talking about things that we took for granted, let's not overlook the blessing of having been able to come together for all of these years, tens of thousands of people, and to learn with one another and to elevate our own spirituality while continuing to invest in such an important institution in our community. This institution is absolutely essential to us. ICNA is a comprehensive institution, and it has behind it some of the most sincere and hardworking people that you will ever meet, whether it's in the relief area or in the dawah area, or whatever it is, even a spirit of service that's cultivated through young Muslim brothers and young Muslim sisters. It's an incredible organization, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we're saying, Allahumma balighna Ramadan, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to live to see Ramadan. May Allah allow us to gather with one another at the next ICNA convention, inshallah ta'ala, whenever it is rescheduled for, and have that opportunity to embrace one another and to learn with one another and to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together. Allahumma ameen. The topic that I have, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانَ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. When my servants ask of me, then indeed I am near. I answer the call of the caller when he calls upon me, so then let them answer my call and believe in me so that they may find success. One of the opportunities that this is giving all of us under lockdown is the opportunity to make our deeds sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no public element to your prayer right now. There's no public element to your charity. You're not going to have an imam or a group of people that are praying tarawih that are looking around to see if you're going to leave after the 2 rak'ahs or the 4 rak'ahs or the 6 rak'ahs. There is not going to be any fundraiser in your masajid saying who's going to give this much and who's going to give that much and the people looking around. No one's going to notice if you come late to the prayer. It is you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if you have at the most your family around you right now. And so it's an opportunity to not just gain a greater closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but to gain a greater awareness of His sight in a way that makes you long for it. And I want to talk about this idea of being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inni qareeb. I am with you. There's a ma'iyya, there's a way that Allah is with us, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always hears, sees us, knows about us. We are always under His power and control, and that is the case for the one who is righteous and for the one who is wicked. But when Allah is with you in the sense that His pleasure is with you, His aid is with you, His guidance is with you, that you are longing for Him and He is guiding you to those paths and through those paths back to Him, that's a very special position to be in. And there's something that Allah tells us in the Quran, إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ كَدَحًا فَمُلَاقِي. you're tripping up and you're stumbling and you're toiling on your way back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely you will meet him. I mean, at the end of the day, whether you go through this life with ease or whether you go through it with hardship, you're going to end up in the grave and then raised in front of Allah. Whether you drive a $10,000 car or a $2,000 car or a $200,000 car or no car at all, you're going to end up in the same grave and you're going to end up standing before the same Lord. Whether you had a mansion or you were homeless, you're going to end up in the same grave and end up standing before the same Lord. Whether you are righteous or wicked, whether you denied death or worked for it, whether you did what you had to do to prepare your home in the hereafter, or you convinced yourself or deluded yourself into thinking that there is no hereafter, you're going to end up in the hereafter on the same plane, standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your same Lord. So innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadihan famulaqi. You're stumbling, toiling. Some people are flipping upside down. Some people are smooth sailing. Everyone is going back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's only a matter of time. And sometimes people escape their inevitable reality only with their imagination. And that's one of the dangerous things that Allah tells us about ghurur, about this idea of self-deception and delusion, that we just escape the idea of resurrection, the idea of return, because it's an inconvenient thought. But again, not all thoughts about death and having to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have to be depressing and debilitating. In fact, they can cause a person to live a fuller life, a life of greater joy, and to be more. Why? The saying of Yunus ibn Ubayd, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa rahimahullah, he said, As-sa'idu fi dunya man taraka dunya qabla an tatruka dunya. That the one who is pleased in this life is the one who abandons this life before it abandons him. Was-sa'idu fi dunya man bana qabrahu qabla an yaskuna. And the one who is pleased in this life, or the one who is happy in this life, is the one who builds his grave before he occupies it. It's an inevitable residence and settling place for all of us. Have you built it? Have you worked towards its construction? Not in the physical sense, but in the way that you've prepared how you're going to dwell in that grave, with the good deeds that will accompany you, with the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with that faith and certainty, that iman and yaqeen that you will keep with you in your heart throughout this world, so that when those angels come to you, you were prepared. And when they ask you the questions about who your Lord is, your faith, your prophet, you're able to answer without any hesitation whatsoever, because you worked towards those things and with those things with certainty. And so we're all going towards that. So as-sa'idu fi dunya man bana qabrahu qabla an yaskuna, the one who is pleased in this world, happy in this world, is the one who constructs their grave before they occupy it. And the last one, as-sa'idu fi dunya man arda khaliqahu qabla an yalqa, that the one who is happy in this life is the one who pleases their Lord before they meet him. It's an inevitable meeting, an inevitable standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. So you might as well please him if you're going to meet him anyway. You might as well beautify your grave if you're going to occupy it anyway. And you might as well abandon this world if it's going to abandon you anyway. Now, abandonment of this world does not mean not doing right with the trust of this world. It means never being deluded by it, never being distracted by it from your ultimate destination, never allowing it to make you unethical, never allowing it to make you amongst those who worship their desires, never allowing it to pull you away from your greater purpose. That's what abandonment, that's what zuhd, asceticism, actually means. So you might as well prepare for your meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you know that you're going to meet him anyway, and you might as well prepare for that meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you know that you're going to be asked in that meeting anyway. It's an interview that's going to take place. It is a standing that's going to take place regardless. So how do I please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before I meet him? And everything that we do right now is in accordance with that meeting. And so, for example, your salah, your prayer, you have a chance to get your prayer done right now, okay? No one's watching you. You're not forced to take your time with your sujood because the imam is taking their time with the sujood. No, you're going to take your time with your prayer. Give every position its right and pray your prayer right. And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, the one who perfects their standing in this life perfects their standing in the next. You're ready for it. No one's going to force you to construct your shade on the day of judgment with charity. You're going to have many online webinars and nightly reflections. And Allah knows all of the organizations that are going to ask you are going to need some help and support to get through. Every one of these nonprofits is going to need the support of the Muslim community. But at the same time, you need that shade on the Day of Judgment. You need that shade as you're waiting for those moments to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's your shade, because the Prophet said a person's shade is their sadaqah. So your shade on the Day of Judgment is your sadaqah in this life. So how are you preparing for that time where you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then the last thing I want to speak about in regards to this is, you know, this concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching you, being with you, of really soaking in that presence. There's a saying that Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah quotes about Imam al-Tustari rahimahullah ta'ala. He said that his father taught him to say before every single night or every night before he sleeps, Allahu ma'i, Allahu shahidi, Allahu nadirun ilayya. That Allah is with me, Allahu ma'i, Allahu shahidi, Allah is witnessing me, Allahu nadirun ilayya, and Allah is watching me. He said, hatta wajadtu halawata, until I found the sweetness of those words. So as a young man, my father would constantly remind me to keep on saying, Allah is watching you, Allah is with you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witnessing you, until he realized the sweetness, the profound nature of those terms, of those words, of those sentences. And here's the thing. We've talked about how everybody is going through their unique set of tests right now. Everyone has their unique set of worries. Some people's worries are certainly greater than others, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect those who are already vulnerable and already struggling before this, and those who will struggle in a greater sense throughout this time, whether that is because of complications with health, wealth, or loneliness, whatever it is. But here's what I want to speak to, okay? You also have a unique set of good deeds that are available to you right now, and you have a unique set of sins. You also, it might be a rahmah, it might be a mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cut you off from some sins. So, you know, subhanAllah, I was reading this article about people that were, you know, that were having affairs or that were committing infidelity. May Allah protect us all. That, you know, the quarantine and you know, the shutdown helps prevent them from that, right? If a person was struggling from some sort of addiction or habit with their technology and their devices, and they relied upon being alone, but now the families are together, so they're not able to access it so easily anymore, that's a rahmah for that person. But it's a test, for example, for the person that has an addiction or has some sort of sinful habit that is about them being alone, and they're alone right now, and they don't have any family around them, and they're particularly addicted to their devices right now. And so you'll see some of those unique tests, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help them overcome those tests. Allahumma ameen. So the point is that in some ways, there is a mercy that is going to be given, and in some ways, there's a great test where there's still a mercy. Because if a person is able to overcome the test of loneliness, the test of quarantine, the test of being restricted from the public, some people are driven to sin by their bad friends, and some people are motivated to good by good companionship, and that's been their habit. So some people depend on the community in Ramadan to spiritually elevate them, and now the community's not there. Some people have, and certainly, you know, friends have an effect on our faith, our companionship has an effect on our faith. Some people have a particularly bad set of companions, and now that's not there anymore, it's a chance to kick the bad habits and the residue of those bad companions on them. The point is that whether it is taqwa through overcoming some of our sinful habits, or whether it is good deeds, ihsan, excellence, doing good deeds, where we set the bar for ourselves and we set the expectations for ourselves, this time is unique for us, and we need to make the most of it. And should we overcome our nufus, ourselves, in private, then certainly we will come back to the public in a better form of ourselves. And I want you to really think about that as closely as possible, inshallah ta'ala. Should you overcome your demons in private and elevate your deeds in private, then when we're all back in public, inshallah ta'ala, we'll all be better versions of ourselves, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. that's going to take you challenging yourself. That's going to take you pushing yourself. Why? Because Allah is with you in private and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you in public. Allah is watching you at all times, at all times. And Allah is giving you an opportunity to thrive, to rise up at all times. And one of those ways, inshallah ta'ala, is of course to support this wonderful organization. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow all of you to find that spiritual fulfillment in these days. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow our hearts to be connected to one another and to be connected to Him. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to ways of goodness, even when we are worried about being locked up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep the shayateen locked away from us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep the malaika always present with us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep His pleasure always our guiding standard, whether we are in private or public. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Omar. MashaAllah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep you on the path to choose you to do the work of the deen and for the community in America and beyond, really to benefit from what we've learned today, inshallah. So with that, we will move, inshallah, to conclude this session. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.